matriculados aí na nossa disciplina. Estou com o Adriano. Adriano, consegui mandar o 3.1, né? Enfim, o Adriano está lá no item 3.1 no Telegram, está meio escondido ali. O texto está lá. Tá? E aí, bom, temos hoje a apresentação do seu coach. Aproveitamos aí a presença dele. Tá? E aí na próxima quarta a gente aproveita para fazer uma discussão mais aprofundada entre a gente, um seminário mais aprofundado, com base nos textos do anterior e na leitura do próprio texto do grupo. Tá? Bom, dito isso, né, os demais participantes que estão fazendo o curso, eu gostaria de agradecer novamente. I would like to thank again for another lecture. Presenting your paper, and I hope that we can have a good discussion after for a moment. I'd like to give space to your lecture.
Thank okay. You. Obrigado, Sérgio. Bom dia a todos. I would like to thank again my colleague of the Instituto. To begin with, Professor Fernando Sarti, the director of the Institute, Sergio, Simone, and other colleagues, we welcome so much during 4 weeks, and I really enjoyed, not only for research reasons, but also for friendly reasons, to stay here, and I hope we will have a good discussion after this this talk. I will address today, as the title shows up, transnational corporation as financial groups. I have been working for years on that. I have been publishing papers, including in translated in Portuguese, on the need for research to reassess to some extent what we mean with enterprise. In general, as I showed you, you have small enterprise or self-employed enterprise, small enterprise, middle enterprise, big enterprise, and at the end of the spectrum, you have large global or transnational or multinational corporation. I think that now, and for a couple of years, so to speak, transnational corporations are not only bigger and more internationalized than other firms, they form a category of enterprise of their own. And it's my purpose to show you that, in my view, this could be considered as financial or rentier groups. I will explain financial and rentier, of course, in the course of my talk. So those are the two basic hypotheses. The one I just mentioned before. Yes. I'm not sure it works. You can read the arrow, yes, okay. And the second hypothesis is the fact that there is an increasing blurring of production and financial related flows within transnational corporation activities, transform them into financial and rentier group. So, let's be comfortable. I will not address all this point at length. I would remind again that my PPT slides are freely available from everyone is interested with. So I will very quickly jump on the first part of my presentation, on the second part of our presentation, also on the first part, and mainly address this 3 points. So let me just very briefly remind you that transnational corporation, I prefer this word used by UNCTAD to multinational enterprise, but I do not see a real significant difference in the wording, of course, are very strong, a very strong grip on the world economy. I just list some kind of significant facts to evidence this. You can see that according to my estimate, transnational corporation valued as a share of world GDP is around 16%. And you can see also that as far as we are discussing of innovation, as it is more or less correctly measured by R&D, research and development, you can see a very strong concentration of R&D expenditures around a top 1,500 companies. But these facts are not sufficient. You can get into detail and see that there is a stronger concentration than these figures allows to assume. For instance, you can see that the top 100 corporations among the 82,000 transnational corporations are very, very important. And you can see again that when we look at business R&D expenditures, the 10 top companies account for a significant share, I mean almost 14% of the total business R&D in the world. So it's very important, with a strong concentration on the triad, I mean North America, Europe and Japan, but increasingly some emerging countries, TNCs, are showing up in the list with Petrobras, Vale, or the China's Huawei. You can see also, as a whole, of course, that the transnational corporation, let me be clear that I am only speaking here of what are called non-financial transnational corporation, of course, it's very important. Suppose you know, I'm not speaking of bank or financial institution as such. I'm speaking of the so-called industrial transnational corporation. You can see that from the last UNCTAD World Investment Report released late year, in October 2013, that the profitability of transnational corporation has been trendy rising, if you accept, of course, the burst, very short burst for them of the recession. But you can see that the rise has resumed since 2010. And you can see from BIS, Bank of International Settlements, that non-financial corporations are, since the beginning of the crisis, much more profitable than non-industrial corporation banks or main banks, financial institutions. So I will very briefly speaking on this section. I was supposed to present somewhat like a course for students, but I think that your own teachers are teaching that things very clearly so far. So I would just put in context what the economic theory has to say or had to say of transnational cooperation. At the beginning of the story, the neoclassical theory had nothing to say, not only about international firm, but also national firm, of course. And the theory began with a kind of trade investment substitute and so on and so forth, with the well-known Mundell approach. And then, of course, with the HOS and Stolper-Samuelson theorem. And at the end of the day, reconforting for the neoclassical cause came in a seminal paper in 37, explaining why there is firm, and basically because there is transaction cause. So the firm is seen as a market failure in cause theory. Of course, this kind of approach has been improved and extended, and including extended at the international level with a neo-institutionalist approach a la Williamson, or in the international field with Enard, but always based on the seminal transaction cost factor. So with explaining why there could be a different strategy by firms as far as foreign direct investment are concerned, horizontal or vertical, I do not extend on that. It's not the purpose, of course. I teach the theory of the multinational firm in France, but it's not my purpose here to explain the heuristic of the multinational firm. And then came, and to some extent, dominant in some quarters, the so-called Olli or Lie-Dunning's eclectic theory with ownership, localization, and internalization, not internationalization. So a very fruitful and useful theory, insufficient in my view, but very fruitful because it borrowed from a multidisciplinary approach, namely with management approach and so on. And then, in my view, somewhat underestimated or too much considered as a cost transaction theory, came Heimer, Stephen Heimer, who died unfortunately very early. So he wrote a couple of papers between, let's say, 67 and 71. Generally, very, very edulcorated theorist. He's just presented as a precursor of Williamson internalization theory. But indeed, if you, and I advise you to read, they are very easily available from an electronic library. If you read Stephen Heimer, remind that he wrote 50 years ago, you can read very, very, very enlightening point in his analysis with some point I just mentioned. Very briefly, I want not to extend on that, but it's just to remind you that Stephen Heimer is not only, in my view, one of the precursors of the real theory of a multinational corporation, but also added very, very good input on multinational corporations, their relation to their national economy, the qualitative change with their internationalization, and so on and so forth. You can read very, very brief, short quotations from him on my slides. So let me go to the core, the backbone of my presentation. That is that transnational corporations should be analyzed as being a category of their own, or on their own, whichever you can choose. To begin with, they are practically organized as a group of enterprise. I've been working for a long time on that, and I know the difficulty to translate not only the word, but the meaning of group, of enterprise. Japanese colleagues are speaking of business group. In the US, the notion of group is very, very underused. Corporation, because corporation is a listed on stock exchange, corporation means group, in fact. So I know the difficulty to translate, but by group, I mean the basic definition, of course, accepted everywhere, and including now in the national accounts, that a group of enterprises is made up of a holding companies with a more or less number of affiliates, the holding companies being in charge and owner, being the owner of their affiliates. And the holding is generally defined, and you have a lot of discussion, especially with related to the accounting of FDI. For instance, in the OECD 28 benchmark for measuring FDI, everywhere, or almost everywhere, holding companies are considered as being only a financial company. I mean only an entity which owns shares and participation in other. This basic and very trivial fact should draw attention for people interested in firm, but indeed, except the national account researcher, we are very concerned with measuring the flow of FDI, trying to disentangle what is really FDI of what is round-tripping FDI or FDI, I will come back on that, in offshore center and so on. But except the national accountants, very few economists are interested with the basic fact that every transnational corporation is, even it's in its financial, in its organizational structure, a financial group. Because you have, at the top of the company, you have, again, an holding company. So, by definition, the group is a structure in which financial control dominates, in my view. Industrial activities, despite financial and industrial capital, are institutionally separated. I mean, in principle, you have the finance capital, which is located in the holding companies, and the productive or industrial capital, which is located in affiliates. We know now, of course, that a lot of affiliates are indeed only set up for financial purposes. So, of course, from this basic and empirical observation that TNC are organized as a financial group with a holding company at the top, of course, we have to move up to the theory, and here I will not bore you with that, but I've been working a lot on that. I think that the concept of finance capital, as it was initially developed by Marx, but there has been a lot of updating, could be quite interesting to explore why and to what extent transnational corporations are financial groups with industrial activities. Of course, you know why capitalism is not only a barter plus means of payment economy. You probably know, of course, that maybe the most outstanding feature of capitalism as distinct of other mode of production is that money capital is at the beginning and at the end of the process. I explained just a couple of minutes this point in my presentation on the banking regulation in Europe. So I accept the view, just explained in a footnote by Marx in Capital, but I think that it's important that capitalism is not the aim of capitalism is not to produce commodities or goods to sell them with a profit. The goal of the logic or the dynamic of capitalism is to make profit, and the production of goods is a mean to make profit. It's not the end objective, in my view at least. Of course, I do not develop this point. So what is relevant for my today presentation is that you have a natural, inherent separation between productive and financial forms of capital. Capital, in my view, is not a thing. It's not an equipment good or a financial asset. Capital, in my view, is a kind of social relation which allows the owner of capital to extract value from others or from nature and so on. So capital as a concept, as an abstraction, is a social relation which incarnates in concrete forms whichever financial asset, equipment good, and so on. But then the separation between productive and or industrial and financial forms are derived from the capital as a social relation. Of course, and I am not in on the side of people explaining that the crisis is mainly and only due to the extravagant rise of the financial sector. I of course think that finance is very important for explaining the crisis, but I do not explain here, just at the end of my presentation, but not at length, that the 2007 crisis burst not only for financial reasons proper, but also in relation with the underlying difficulties, if not contradiction, of productive accumulation. I will just give you at the end of my presentation one or two slides, because it's not the purpose of my presentation, but I think that the crisis is both a crisis of due to the dominated finance capital regime of accumulation, but also a crisis on the real side of the economy, or of the productive side of economy. So I make this point just to explain that, differing to some extent from my very good post-Keynesian colleagues in France, of course, finance capital is accountable for the crisis, but behind or in relation with the outgrowth of finance capital, you have to look at the real things, like the real rate of profitability in non-financial corporations. So of course it's an illusion that capital could reproduce only through finance activities. Of course it depends at the end of the day on value created by labor and wealth, because I think that it's important when we look now at the relation between capital and nature, to look that, in my view at least, in the 30 last years, capital has been able to capture and to appropriate in a private way what used not to be considered as commodity, I mean labor produced. I think of nature and to some extent knowledge. So I add to labor value, I add the ability for three decades at least by capital to prioritize to some extent what could be considered as a common good or a public good, but I prefer the word common good to public good. So finance capital, in my view, because I did not define yet, I did not give you a definition of my understanding of finance capital, it is both an institutional organization, I mean finance capital as a sector, the financial sector with bank and non-bank or monetary and non-monetary institution, which is a distinct sector from automotive, energy, and so on, the so-called FIRE for finance, insurance, and real estate sectors, as used to say the US. But it's also, and I'm more interested in this way, it's also a functional category, finance capital. I mean the ability of money to act as capital and to generate through its own process more value or more price than it had at the beginning. So finance capital for me is to just borrow from the classical taxonomy by Marx, it is something like M bringing about M prime being having more price or value than money, M at the beginning. Again, this functionality is, in my view, inherent to capitalism. I mean the functional separation between productive and financial capital allows finance capital to develop its own autonomy, the autonomy of money capital, money capital being a distinct sphere of productive capital, and of course, not only a structural separation, it has been then institutionally built over decades because, of course, a strong tendency for capitalists, for agents, to look for very, very short way to make profit, and in principle, it's very, very more convenient to look for profit by lending money, by buying shares that being involved in a very, very tortuous and risky and uncertain process of production. Of course, we know from that point, Schumpeter was very important to explain why the entrepreneur, to some extent, was an irrational, from a strict capitalist view, was irrational because he took a lot of risk and so on and so forth. It was a basic of Schumpeter to explain that. And of course, I just very briefly move on that. The institutional construction of the autonomy of finance is just described here with the growth of stock markets. Of course, a very, very, very defining moment with what is called globalization, but mainly and firstly was finance globalization. And within the process which took place in the last 30 years, more recently, I could say, in the 10 last years, the increasing porosity between bank system and financial markets stimulated endogenous mechanism for steep rise of fictitious capital. We discussed this point in my last presentation on the banking regulation. I think that between the Minskian and Marxist-inspired researchers, there is a kind of convergence, of course, with disagreement, but on the idea that thanks to deregulation and financial innovation, capital has been able to reproduce and to grow out of control thanks to endogenous process is now a well-established fact, I think, on the heterodox side, going from post-Keynesian to Marxist. So, of course, this theoretical background was needed to introduce. I hope not to have been too long, but I very stick to theoretical principle. Of course, transnational corporation, being financial group, have been able in the last decade to amplify to some extent their financial activity through globalization, real globalization, I mean globalization of their activities and so on and so forth. And of course, a very basic idea, but I think important, is that they have been able to build an integrated, so to speak, an internal, if you want, but integrated global space which with financial and industrial operation being addressed in a combined way. Suffice if you found this sentence too much theoretical or abstract, suffice to read to the huge empirical literature by national accounter on how to measure FDI. So my claim that financial and industrial operations are going end in end is not an abstract claim. So global means what it means on this slide. The world has become a playing field for locating and sourcing their activities. And valorization of capital, global also means that, in my view. Global is not only geographical bounded, it's also global in the spectrum of opportunity of valorization for capital. Global in the sense not of a territory, but of a world view. Global, Portuguese, I'm sure, has the same meaning. Global means not only geographical reach. Of course, mainly we think of when we address transnational cooperation, but I try to explain that global also means the ability by large transnational corporations to have a very global strategy, meaning a very large, broad spectrum of possibility for valorization of their capital, going from the pure productive investment, I mean capital accumulation in equipment good, to the pure, so to speak, financial investment or financial asset, but within the two ends of the spectrum, a mix of opportunities. So the integrated global space has been, in my view, well captured with the theory of global commodity chain or global production chain. I do not discuss the difference between them. It is this point that I will address in a moment. So, what does mean basically what has been in the industrial economics literature called the restructuring of TNC's global commodity chain? You know that, of course. I just very briefly some the state of art of the literature. First, in relation with the shareholder revolution and so on, corporation, I mean financial groups, TNCs, have been seen by their shareholder, of course their manager. In my view, the top managers are owners, they are members of the ruling class, have been seen as a bundle of financial assets, and this view required the slicing up, the separation of the global value chain, including in the structural organization of the large corporation, the need to separate very strictly activities to check which activities is profitable and which is not. And that means that, at least for a lot of critical thinkers in the management literature, this kind of slicing up of activities within the group has meant a loss of synergies and cross-fertilization between the different affiliates or branches of the national corporation. Outsourcing, of course, combined with offshoring, do not extend on that. Refocusing on some non-manufacturing segments, I mean the repositioning along the global value chain has meant for very large corporations dropping manufacturing activities, outsourcing them in general, and focusing on the two hands of their global value chain, I mean upstream of the value chain R&D activities, but I just will explain that with more focusing on development close to the market than in research, branding, reputation, IP, intellectual property, and patenting, which are at the lower end, so to speak, of the downstream of the global value chain. value chain. And in my view, it's a way for transnational corporations to drop their productive activities and to focus on financial activities proper, of course, but also on what I call, and it's very important, I will explain theoretically my point of view, rente activity. In general, when we think of rent activities, we think of financial activities. I just try for a couple of years, 3 or 4 years, to explain that we need to expand what is called in general the financialization of transnational corporations. It's the very usual term, financialization. You have noted that I did not use it up to now, because I think that it is a broader move than only having financial revenue. I mean, it is a kind, I just explained in a moment, a kind of orientation away from productive activity toward more rent generating or capturing activities. I would say here, it's absolutely needed, of course, that it is a tendency. One, all the large transnational corporations have not the same strategy, so you have some transnational corporations which still remain more committed and focused on productive activities. No doubt about the Chinese transnational corporations, that they are very strong on productive activities. So what I am explaining here is not a kind of one size fits all for any transnational corporation. It's more a kind of theoretical background. I can buttress my theoretical background on case studies, I will give figure, but you should not see that as a kind of again, one size fits all. There is one difference between corporations, often between national corporations. Chinese corporations are more productive oriented than American corporations, for instance. And two, of course, it's a trend, it's a tendency. If industrial corporations stopped their productive activities, they would stop to be industrial non-financial corporations. And probably they would bankrupt because I do not think that Apple or General Motors are better than the huge banks existing today to make a real financial business. So it's very important to stick to the point that non-financial corporations remain involved in the production activities. But, in my view, by producing less and less themselves and trying, of course, to go on controlling the productive activities, no doubt about that, they are obsessed with that. All the refocusing is aimed at controlling the value created in the production, but they are themselves less and less productive entities as such. So I will make the point many times. Because the time is flying out, I move very briefly on the next slide. I mean, the global value chain, in my view, is very useful category or concept to analyze industrial strategy of transnational corporations. So the global value chain started from Porter, Michael Porter, but with very strong critique addressed to him, namely not taking into account the international dimension of the global value chain. And then, of course, the whole literature initiated by, among others, by Jeffrey and Sturgeon and so on, so-called MIT Global Commodity Chain School. So I move very briefly not to eat another part of my presentation. You can see very empirically, but also I will move very quickly, what does mean concretely a global value chain. It was a simplified, the word simplified is used in the OECD report, a very simplified global value chain, the ability by transnational corporations to organize a very, very international and internal trade of goods and services. You can see, for instance, that value-added exports, that is value-added produced in a country and absorbed in another country, dramatically rose in the two last decades from 15% of the world GDP to 22% in 2008, meaning that the value added, and we are interested with value, the value added is more and more circulating at the world scale and still remain dominated by OECD TNCs, even if you have the emerging of the BRICS countries, but probably you know when the BRICS category is used, often it is forgotten that within BRICS, China holds an overwhelming share of what is called BRICS. So you have in the next slide, but I will move very quickly, two examples to give some substance to what I mean by disengaging of productive activities. You have first the case of the iPhone or iPad, iPhone in this case, and you can see that out of the final price of an iPhone, the cost of input in China was only 1.8% of the final cost, while Apple profits accounted for almost 60% of the sale cost of the price of sale. Sorry. Incidentally, maybe you know it's amazing because it is to some extent at counter current of the mainstream literature. You probably follow, if you are interested with innovation, the annual report by Booz and Hamilton, and it's quite interesting. It's a consulting company, but they publish the yearly analysis of the 1,000 or 1,500 top innovative companies. And each year, again this year, they make the point that they claimed to have found no relation at all between the amount of R&D spent by companies and the ranking and the rate of innovation by the same company. Amazing, of course, because in innovation economics as such, it used to be said that the input was R&D and the output was innovation. Of course, I'm critical of that, but it's really the basic thing. And Booz and Hamilton strongly defend the case, and I mention that because they again cite Apple as being seen as the one or the second world top innovative company in the world, while spending relatively little on R&D. So it's quite interesting, and I'm imagining for people working on innovation. It's not my main point, it's just to explain that you cannot explain that Apple realize or accounts for 60% of the sales only because Apple is involved in very, very huge R&D activities or productive activities and so on. It's really for other reasons. Here you have the details, the breakdown of the cost of the iPhone. And what is interesting to just connect the micro level of the transnational corporation with the macro level of trade between countries. I probably you know, of course, but I just remind you that the United States are very strongly complaining with a rising deficit with China in manufactured goods. But if you look at the value added computed trade between China and the U.S., especially in the case, but it's true in general. But if you look at the case of the iPhone, you can see that test here. The trade surplus with the US in the iPhone was $1.9 billion if you compute the traditional accounting trade. I mean, how iPhone I export from China and boost by the US. But if you look through the value added, and you know probably that there is a very, very strong reshuffling of the measurement of international trade by a joint effort by WTO, OECD, and UNCTAD. If you look at the value added trade between China and the US, you observe that in reality, the US balance is slightly positive with China. That means that in China, there is strong export of iPhone, and of course, the deficit is yawning for the US, but the iPhone produced in China are made with inputs which are imported from the US or from Korea or from other companies, and now the international trade take into account this kind of flow. It is able to see that if an affiliate of Motorola in Korea produce components which are then sold to China to be integrated in an iPhone, by value-added trade measure, this should be seen as an export from the US, because Motorola is a US company, even if its affiliate is based in Korea or in Taiwan, should be considered as an export by a US company, so for the US in general, to China, so an import for China. So you have the same case, but I move very briefly on the Nokia, also cell phone, with roughly, it's quite interesting, roughly the same distribution of the cost profits of a Nokia cell phone. I mean, Nokia captured, because Nokia had some troubles for a couple of years, but just until 2012, captured around 50%. You remember, for Apple, it was 58 or so. So you can see that transnational corporations, some of them, are a very, very leading position, able to capture a significant share of the value, the price of a good. And finally, in a non, maybe more striking, because you could advocate that if Nokia and Apple are taking 50 or 60% of the value of the good, it's because they are very innovative, so it's a reward for the innovator in a superior way. But you can see exactly the same process in non high-tech industries, and I just borrowed from a Fang Global Institute the same process in a very conventional jacket, where you can see that what is called very interestingly, invisible assets account for 91% of the final price, the manufacturing cost being only 9% of the final cost. That means that service, retail, logistic, banking, intellectual property, profit, but what is intellectual property if it is not profit? What does mean retail if it's not profit and other unknown? Probably because there is a lot of move between the OECD countries where the jacket is sold and offshore financial center. But at the end of the day, you can see that almost the totality of the cost of a jacket is captured by corporation being able to raise the value of the good up to the point to capture 91%. So you have different explanations for this kind of situation, of course, you are the classical, I mean, how to explain the, not the repositioning of transnational cooperation on the global value chain. It's quite explained, outsourcing, offshoring, and so on, but how to explain the ability by leading companies in a global value chain to capture, to accaparate a significant part share of the value created along all along the chain. So you have different explanations, of course, the classical industrial economics power market. But here, and as often with this kind of theory, these theories could be good, but it is only focused on market. And upstream of the market, you have to produce, in my view, to produce the good and also to produce the value. So the power market is could be somewhat ambiguous notion. It is not false in my view, but it is very restricted to market, as if it was only on the market that large corporations are competing. No, the global value chain means that they are not competing only downstream on the market, they are also competing all along the creation of the value of the good, which is aimed at being sold on a market. They are competing at this level, and we could see that with Apple and other companies. You have, of course, I'm quite sympathetic too with the oligopoly theory, but one of the weaknesses that they go back to the 60s and they were invented in a domestic, for domestic purpose mainly, and we have now to integrate the globalization, the world dimension, which reflects qualitative change and not only the transition from national to international. Basically, that means that you cannot translate only the oligopoly theory at the world level. You have to take into account, for instance, what does mean global value chain. I mean, it's not exactly oligopoly, which has more or less restricted to market again, to market sharing by some leading company. You have to think of the production upstream of the market. You have a very interesting explanation by one of the founding father of the orthodox explanation for global value chain, Baldwin, who is very interesting, one of probably the most famous economist in the field of international economy as far as the level of firm is concerned. And he explained, of course, and some of you are probably very familiar with that, the repositioning of the transnational corporation at the two end of the spectrum, upstream and downstream, but what he called the smile curve, because the graph is supposed to smile, but indeed it's a very, very basic and trivial reminder of probably you know as an international economist, of course, the so-called flying G's theory, which explains that countries would develop along this kind of way. And he observed very recently in a very voluminous report, curiously, it's my emphasis, curiously, value added along the value chain seemed to shift away from the offshore stages. Basically, the stuff is produced in China for 1.9% of the total iPhone value or of the jacket, I don't know how. Offshore stage means very low value produced, but the value is moving, is shifting away from this and moving where we don't know exactly, but shifting away from offshore stages. Baldwin is not interested with looking at international intellectual property, patenting, and so on. He does not analyze this kind of fact. And another quotation of Baldwin is worthwhile. Offshore tasks tend to be things that can be done in many emerging nations, a kind of natural division of labor, the non-offshore states, by contrast, tend to involve things where firms naturally, have market power due to product differentiation, branding, etc. I think that if a first year undergraduate student wrote in a dissertation or in a test, but it's natural that some companies are leading over others, it would be very rightly sanctioned and punished by his or her teacher. No comment. So I would just address in the last part of my presentation what I explained in the beginning. I will be probably shorter than I would, but I prefer to devote some time to the discussion. My basic point, as I said many times now, is that because they are financial groups, because they are not industrial companies as such, but they are financial groups with industrial activities, TMCs are rent seekers. And of course, financial profit, in my view, are a category, but the main category, but then the unique category of rent. I think of intellectual property and so on. So, as I explained in the beginning, for the coming years, my theoretical challenge is to extend the category of finance capital as the ability for the owner of capital to extract value from other people, even if they are not producing goods, but by the very fact that they are owning capital, they can impose a kind of extraction of value on other people or nature. One of my theoretical challenges is to try to connect that to the rent literature. I did it in a recent French written paper by exploring what does it mean rent. So very briefly, you know that the seminal foundation for rent, for industrial, for firms in general, was found in Ricardo's work with the differential rent, of course. And this kind of explanation of why there is a marginal productivity by Ricardo was extended to industrial activities with no problem bypassing, no problem to transfer something which applies to a finite resource like land to unlimited industrial activities. It's a catchword for the mainstream. I mean, in the basic meaning for the orthodox theory, a rent is a portion of earnings in excess of the minimum amount needed to attract a worker to accept a particular job or a firm to enter a particular industry. In general, rent is a return in excess of the resource owner's opportunity cost. Of course, it's very challenging to accept this kind of definition, which is defined in comparison with the ideal type of the market. I mean, a rent is what happens when the market is not cleared. So it would be good or it could be bad. Of course, you have to love literature, not only for Schumpeter, but other explaining that rent are good. For instance, just by passing and you can see the role of social forces in my example. When Microsoft was threatened by the US Department of Justice to be dismantled, to be broken up, because it was considered as in a monopoly, an abuse of monopoly position, you had a lot of Chicago economists which explained that the solution would be worse than the solution would be worse than the existing situation. I mean, if we dismantled Microsoft, it was a loss of dynamism, technological innovation, and so on. So it was better to maintain Microsoft, even if Microsoft was a giant, because using the Schumpeterian theory in a very, very particular way, Posner and other Chicago economists explained that someday innovation would reverse the trend and would change, move very quickly on the Schumpeterian range. We should devote a seminar to Schumpeter, because I read a lot Schumpeter, and of course it has been drawn in whichever meaning you want, but it's not my point today. So I prefer to focus my last point on what I think of rent and finance. I connect to some extent the both categories. They are not similar, of course, but they are interrelated. And in particular, in the activity of transnational corporations, they are interrelated. My view is what just I explained a moment ago, that because they have capital, some people, agents, institutions are able to capture profits. And this means the blurring of the boundaries between profits accruing from economic activities, what is usually called the production process, and rents generated by property rights, financial lands, natural resources, housing, intellectual, and so on. And it's why I try to explain in my French written paper that to some extent at odds with what is developed in the heterodox literature, rents cannot be only on a distributional category. I mean, like something which could happen after the value or after the production has been made. So you would have a kind of competition, let's say, between the industrialist who want to capture value and the lender to the industrialist, to the bank also, which would also capture a share of the value. Of course, at the end of the day, it seems to be a distribution category, because you can observe how the value has been distributed within capital. I do not speak between labor and capital here. But in my view, it's more complex, and one of my aims, to some extent challenge, is to show that there is an increasing blurring between the so-called industrial profits and the financial or rentier profit or revenue. And of course, but very quickly, I borrow and read again what Marx wrote about what he called the absolute rent, differing of the differential rent of Ricardo and all the economics. Absolute rent is really a Marxist category on its own, and it is basically, there are very other texts, but the fact that one section of the society exacts from another a tribute for the permission of inhibiting the earth. This sentence has been widely used by a critical environmentalist to show how capital was exploiting nature to some extent. It's not my point here. It's my point only that observe that if we go back to capital as a social relation, so it means the power of people to extract value from other people. And you have to make the jump to understand the blurring between industrial profit drawn from activities and rentier profit, including financial revenue drawn from only owning financial assets or real estate assets, etc. To understand the blurring of them, you have to go back to the abstract category of capital thought of as a social relation between people, so involving power relations. So very, very briefly, because I am late in my presentation, this kind of analysis, from my point of view, explain or account for to some extent what is usually observed, I mean the refocusing downstream the value chain, all the point I mentioned before. I mean, large transnational corporations are devoting more resources to patenting, branding, advertising, protecting their market in the real sense than they are spending in productive activities. And in my view, of course, it's a kind looking for rents on the market, but the rent on the market at Apple or Nokia or the seller of jackets is able to extract is based on power relation in its global value chain. You can, in my view, maybe begin to explain why there is this kind of downstream moving with a huge expenditures devoted, for instance, to marketing and branding. I mentioned just bypassing some data on that. So I am here just listing down what kind of consequences of the strategy of transnational corporation looking for capturing rents. The first point is the downstreaming along the value chain. The second point is the repositioning of activities from R&D to still called R&D, but in fact, often, more than often, very, very, very close to the market development. And sometimes it has been observed by some analysis in the US, some activities which are even not R&D, but pure advertising, lobbying campaign, I think of pharmaceutical companies, which go on calling it R&D because of tax or political reasons, because R&D is very, very noble. But indeed are not R&D at all. So this kind of move from a lot, not all, of course, corporation is a part of the attempt to capture value on the money. When you are having R&D, you never know if you will be a successful output as a product innovation or so. When you are just capturing the market, you are more comfortable or supposed to be more comfortable. So I just mentioned the case of the pharmacy with a very, very strange effect that the more you have R&D and the less you have of invention of a new molecule. So it's amazing, and you can see a very, very amazing data collected from US sources in which for $1 spent in basic research, and pharmaceutical is said to be a very high tech with very strong basic research needed, the ratio to marketing expenditure is 1 to 19, meaning that pharmaceutical companies spent 19 times more for lobbying, marketing, and so on, packaging, than they are expending on basic research. And I just mentioned, but I already did make the point, the case of the Brazilian pharmacy drawn from a Brazilian paper. So one of the way, of the further way to consolidate their rent, of course, for transnational corporation is to cooperate with their government. Of course, there is no doubt that large transnational corporations are not apatrid, they are not countryless. I am not on the side of the thought which claims that transnational corporations have nothing to do with their home market. I think that it remains very important, and you can check by many examples, but Nonetheless, the transnational index given by UNCTAD, which shows that indeed, even in 2013, the last report, transnational corporations are not so internationalized as management literature, for instance, used to claim. So there are some corporations are very close from their government, and you can see, for instance, very interesting paper by, probably you know him, of course, so Bill Lazonik, William Lazonik, and one of his former students and now professor at Sussex University, Mazzucato, in Tulum, another Lazonik student, Finnish researcher now, who wrote a very interesting paper showing to what extent even the so-called iPhone, iPad, and so on, had been buttressed on public, governmental, federal, or state funding in the US. And not only in the US, they found that the CERN, the European Research Nuclear Center, even support financially Apple. I don't know exactly which way, but support the creation, the innovation by Apple. So the point of course is to stress that behind the so-called Schumpeterian entrepreneur and so on and so forth, you are not only a collective. You know the work by Lazonik is very, very stressing on the role of firm and organization, but you have also the role of governmental support, which is critical, especially, you could not think of it probably before this slide and before the reading of this paper, but even for very high innovative products. So you have also, as a rent generating activities, the building of opacity for tax avoidance purpose. I do not extend on that very very long, but it's very important, and it was called the double Irish Dutch sandwich in some cases. I have just reproduced and comment just to make it more easier to read the way mainly US, but not only US corporations, were able not to pay taxes or very underpaid taxes to the IRS, the tax gathering US institution. You can see here the amount of taxes saved by the US transnational corporation not paid to the US institution. It was a very interesting Levine report, 2012, aftermath the financial crisis, to try to take back some money evaded or avoided, as you want, by the U.S. companies. So the amount is quite significant. The case of Apple is still more significant. They paid a total of $3.3 billion of total tax for a 34 or so profits, and the same case, just less, by Walmart. The difference between both could be explained by the extraordinary ability by so-called high-tech companies to avoid taxes through the trade of what is called intangible. You remember that for the jacket you have a lot of items, and those items now account for a significant share of the intra-trade, intra-company trade I mentioned before. I mean, it's very difficult for regulators to check that affiliates in France from a US-owned company paid, for instance, IP fees to another affiliate of the same group located in Ireland, because Ireland is a very free tax, generous country. So it's very difficult. Of course, it's difficult too for marketing. I ought to check that the Swiss affiliates of a German companies received from the German affiliate of the same company a huge sum because the Swiss affiliates made marketing activities and so on and so forth. So the invisible assets, or what I call the intangible assets, have become a very, very efficient way for large transnational corporations to avoid or to evade the tax basis. You have the case, but it's too far now to comment on that. You have the case of emerging multinational corporations. I just mentioned on this side the case of Brazil and China, which account for the most of emerging market economy offshore financial centers bond issuance. And you can see the rise of issuance by Brazilian companies in offshore financial centers. And you can see it's very interesting paper. I advise my colleague to read it, written by Chung and his colleague just in the beginning or at the beginning of this year. It's an IMF paper in which they explain the significant role of non-financial transnational corporation in the creation of what they call the global liquidity. They try to disentangle and to understand why there is so much spilling, accelerating creation of global liquidity. My language is fictitious capital, and they analyze, and to some extent a path-breaking attempt, they analyze the role of non-financial corporation. Of course, you can think of bank and financial institutions, shadow banking, for instance, are being very creative in the creation of global liquidity. But they explain, and I just extract this kind of graph, they explain how, I repeat, non-financial corporation, and in this case from emerging country, and in this case more precisely from Brazil, are able, by borrowing from international capital market US dollar, to produce, of course, affiliate, US affiliate from a Brazilian corporation, to lend this money to the home group, company, or another Brazilian affiliate. And this affiliate is able to create, from this point, through the role of bank, of course, new money, so to speak. So they are not able to practice what is called carry trade. I don't know if you know. I mean, take profit of the difference in the rate of exchange between dollars and reals. But they are also contributing through the deposit made, let's say, in a Brazilian bank, to the creation of the so-called global liquidity. And this point was addressed also in this paper. It could be of some interest for you to explain the role of the type of monetary policy to be carried out by national government, Brazilian in this case, in case of rate of exchange instability. But it's not my point. So you have some explanation of that. You can see toward the end of my presentation the rise of financial revenue proper, I mean financial rents, if you want, proper. I did not extend on that. You might have been surprised, but this point is very, very documented, so I did not explain at length. But of course, you have to take into account two basic facts in the three last decades. One, a dramatic change in the distribution between capital and labor earnings within the value added, and two, within the capital revenue or the profit revenue, the change of the distribution between industrial the retained earning and dividend payout. I mean the rise of what is usually called financialization, but it's only one of the aspects of financialization, the fact that more and more profits drawn from the productive sphere are distributed to shareholders or to lenders. So you can see that's a unique case. It's exactly the same case in Europe, in France and Germany and UK. You can see the strong rise of as a share of retained of operating surplus, basically the gross profit of a transnational corporation. You can see the significant rise of the dividend payout in the last period, and you can see, I have no time to extend on that, but you can see a very amazing fact observed in the last 3 or 4 years only, just after the beginning of the so-called financial crisis, the extravagant rise of cash held by non-financial transnational corporations. Sorry. It's really significant. You can see that the cash to net assets has been rising. And just to finish my presentation, I would go back to the real side. I would stress that all I explained was not only a pure financial game. Of course, you understood that I spoke of non-financial transnational corporation, but I would say that this kind of strategy aimed at generating more rent, and including but not only financial rents, has a relation with the real side. And just to conclude, it's really my just before last slide, you can see that, of course, everybody knows the corporate decision tree. A company could, from the profits it draws, distribute between tax, dividend, or retained earning. Retained earning could be used for capital expenditures or for corporate savings. Basically, corporate savings, meaning you are not investing in the real activities here too, of course, but here you are not even within retained earning, often considered as a benchmark for industrial production, industrial investment. But you can see that retained earnings is only the beginning of the decision process to invest or not. And if you are not investing in production, you are basically investing in financial activities, including cash. And you can see in relation with the real world, because again, I do not think that finance is outgrowing by itself. It had to be in relation with the so-called over-accumulation crisis, or call it whichever you want. You can see a very interesting graph I just collect from Standard & Poor's. Just 1 minute to explain this case. Standard & Poor's said, okay, we are a global company, but national accounts do not alone to look at the strategy of transnational corporations, because national accounts are, by definition, national-based. So France can say what share of the profit has been invested by French company in France, but they cannot, in France, the National Accounting Institution, cannot say how Carrefour, Casino, and so acted in the world, because they have not the power, the skill, and so on. So it's very difficult. So we, Standard & Poor's, quite interesting, decided with the database we have to publish each year, each semester indeed, a study on the top 1,000 corporations. Could you imagine that you have here the equivalent of what national account or even OECD for FDI, for instance, are doing? It's quite interesting. And when you look, so it's freely available, of course. There is the same study on the European firm. And I was amazed. It was October or November 2013 Standard & Poor's report, I was amazed to observe, like you observe, that non-financial capex, capital expenditures, I mean, productive investment, if you will, growth, are not only being declining in trend in the last year, but in 2013 and 14 will be negatively growing. I mean, the top 1,000 or one, yes, 1,000 top transnational corporations will be productively less investing, they announced, of course, but it can be believed, that they will be less investing in production activities, in capital investment activities, sorry, in 13 and 14 than they did in the past. I think that it's a very, very striking graph to conclude my presentation, and in particular to connect the growth of financial activities with what is really happening on the productive side. And you can see the same kind of evidence by very good blog by Michael Roberts, and a Marxist economist, Marxist American, but with very, very quite interesting documented and so, and he discussed the notion of cash flow, because there has been a lot of discussion, I do not get into the detail, on why companies are piling up so much cash, and he showed a very, he built a very interesting graph showing that, of course, the rate of fixed investment, well, investment as a share of international cash decline, meaning the rise of cash compared to fixed investment, but it is mainly secular trend. So effectively, they have more cash than the average. But he explained is not so much. It's just evident in the in another graph I did not show here. He showed that it's not so much the size of cash which has been piling up in the last year as the very low level of fixed investment. So we are brought back to the same point made by Standard & Poor's, the accumulation of cash, which is really in the Keynesian meaning the most liquid form of money capital. I think you have understood my point. It's a way that to show that non-financial corporations are even keeping money capital through the most liquid form, so meaning very, very speculative activities. The reason is to connect, it has to be connected to, with, sorry, the very low level of fixed investment, and of course for Michael Roberts, like for me, it's an evidence that we are plagued not only with a financial crisis or a financialization of transnational corporation, of course it is, but also with a very, very underlying structural accumulation crisis.
Question reading your paper, I would like just to ask you to say a little bit more about the role of intangible assets in this process of increasing rent, increasing importance inside of the operation to extract rent out of the assets, even tangible and mainly intangible assets. In your paper, you mentioned that Veblen was a pioneer in this question. I would like to add that Hobson, his work from early 20th century, too, is a very interesting point about the intangible assets. John Hobson.
Hobson.
Evolution of modern capitalism. I would like to just ask you to make a little comment about the role of the
Yes.
I'd like to compliment you for your awesome presentation. Fantastic. For great erudition and complex grasp of different aspects in a coherent view. I'd like to raise a point that was brought for my reading of your paper on socio-economic digital. Where you make the case that the different forms or moments of the capital circuit are not any longer represented by different unities or fractions of capital separated from one another, mainly because, as you defended here also, that transnational corporations and financial capital are able to transcend and spread to and through different sectors and countries and forms of capital. But on the other hand, you also make the case here that it's also important still to grasp the continuance of the national difference between capitalisms, even though you also contend that financial institutional financial difference between France and UK are not as clear as they once were. What I'd like for you to talk more is if you make this case because do you think it's important to grasp the relations between national policies and transnational corporations that are based in specific countries as far as it relates to the competition policies that these states can enact to strengthen their transnational corporations' ability to dispute markets? Or do you think that is still important and possible to look at different national patterns of capital accumulation. And if it is important, which would be the topics related mainly to public policies, which you think would be necessary to be grasped to defend this?
Thank you for your excellent explanation. I would like to make two brief questions that I think are connected. In your view, when a technological company like Dell, so with high intangible assets, closing its share on the stock market, out of the stock market, what this strategy means? On the other hand, Apple and the Google have double, triple your market capitalization in the 6 years, the past 6 years, despite the global crisis. These trends are contradictory.
Huh?
Some are contradictory or not. Different, né? Or part of the same phenomenon.
I think we can stop because fascinating question. Of course, it's really the point I want to make and the weakness of the point I want to make. I mean, I'm not an expert working in abstract, so I need interaction and that fits my suit and some point. I know the weakness of some of my content. Really, I thank you for the question because the point to the need for me to be more clear, not only in this presentation, but theoretically to be more challenging. I'm sure that it is a collective one. I hope that we can have this kind of discussion again, because I think it's not an isolated process. The most simple, not the more logic, but the more simple is just to take the question in a row. The first question is quite interesting on the role of intangible assets. Indeed, in the paper published in Portuguese, to make the case that within the category of financial capital, the component share, or as an oxymoron, the substance of the financial capital is fictitious capital. Of course, the substance and fictitious could be two words opposed, but the substance is fictitious capital. Again, in my view, very briefly, for me, capital is the power to extract value from other people. So, of course, capitalism needs to produce goods and so on and so forth, there is no doubt, otherwise it would have not been successful for 200 years, there is no doubt about that, but at the end of the day, capitalism is about the appropriation of value. And of course, if you think that 200 years went through the beginning of capitalism, you could think that there are some kind of difficulties or contradiction and so on and so forth looming, including between capitalism and nature, for example, the contradiction of over-exploiting nature, and you could think that the rise of financial or royalty activity is also growing because of contradiction on the real side. So, I repeat this point because it's quite important. And to come to the first question, the role of intangible asset is extraordinarily significant. I spent months and months to understand for this paper, because I was fascinated by that, 2 years or 3 years ago to understand what does mean intangible asset, which is basically everything which is not tangible, so which is not accounted for in business accounting as tangible assets. And of course, private business accountants used to be very cautious. You know that there were flies, they are always very cautious. So, intangible asset, as to some extent, there is a lot of literature on that, being a creation of the financial market proper. It goes back to the end of the 19th century when Veblen, the American socio-economist, wrote about goodwill. It was not inventing a category. It was drawing a large amount of literature, accounting, economists, professional, and so on. Basically, it's the difference between the accounting value of the firms, the goodwill, and the financial value of the company. The point is that in the last 20 years, intangible assets, it's not only made up of goodwill, but the share of intangible assets in the value, the financial value of the company, has been going up to, according to different countries, between 60 and 80% of the total value, the value, financial value, the stock value, if you want, of the company. That means huge share is not explained in the accounting of the company. So it could be the assessment by the market of the value of the brand. Mouet NEC as a champagne is very well valued by the market. But so it is the reason why intangible asset is generally connected by economists to knowledge economy. I mean, there is a kind of parallel. On the one end of economics, you have the emerging knowledge economy. Producing is not important. What is important is to have knowledge. So, of course, everybody has knowledge, but it's not my point. And the financial counterpart, to some extent, of the knowledge economy, is the rise of intangible assets. So you have branding, IP, R&D, which is not really accounted for as an investment, but as an expense, current expense in accounting and so on. But you have also in the 60 or the 80% of intangible assets value, or of the global value of a company, you have also between, according to country, between 13 and 50% of the total of intangible assets, between 30 and 50% of the total of intangible assets accounted by goodwill. And goodwill is only, in accounting sense, not my sense, is only the difference of price paid by the investor, or the financial investor, buying a company on the stock market, and the value of the company as it used to be assessed just at the moment of the buying. So goodwill, which I repeat, account for between 30 and 50% of intangible assets, which are themselves accounting for between 60 and 80% of the total stock value of the company, is only explained by the animal spirits, as used to say Kane, by the stock market. So you have a kind of very interesting reversal of the process, that is now the stock market which are giving value to the companies. So of course they are not fully irrational, of course they prefer to value Google or Apple than a very trivial company, but you have a kind of circular process in which the stock markets give very high value to Google, Apple, and their likes, and meanwhile, these companies are more and more exploiting what the stock market decided to value, I mean, intangible asset, branding, marketing, and so on. You are a kind of feedback effect in which this company will be valued because they will be able to remain at the top of the market, but remaining at the top of the market will be going more and more through, again, branding, reputation, power market, and so on and so forth. So really, intangible asset as a category is quite interesting because it reveals with a great magnitude what, in my view, is called fictitious capital. And of course, the goodwill has been declining in the two last year for most of the company, except Google or Apple, but other companies have been feeling that they have in their hands a kind of empty value, or what Business Week and the professional economic magazine called the paper wealth. The paper wealth. On the second question, quite interesting, where the financial profits are coming from, I think that we have to hold the two ends of the analysis. I mean, there is no doubt that a share, and we could discuss later this point, a share of financial profits are made as on a casino. It was the image made by Keynes, speaking of casino economy. I mean, in a casino, some win what the sum or the amount of money others lose. I think that this kind of image could be misleading. Of course, it's very important that the casino economy has been booming, because that means that there have been building social roots in economy. I mean, when we have just a little stock market with a very few speculators winning and losing, it's not very important. When the casino has become a leading, with the derivative market, for instance, when the casino has become a leading institution, it's not, even if it is only an internal game in which some win what others lose, you can understand that you have behind very powerful investment banks, very powerful actors, and so on. So it can be a casino game. It has taken up the size of a very significant institution. But anyway, I think that it is a misleading image. I mean that the financial revenue are not only drawn from this kind of casino game. It, at the end of the day, to be generated by the value existing, in my view, the value is only created through a labor process, or wealth existing. If you decide to privatize, thanks to government or so, if you decide to privatize what used to be a common good, a land, a parcel of land, and so on, of course, you are drawing profit because you are the owner of the land, not directly of a labor process, but of the privatization of common goods. It's why I speak of wealth, because it's not directly produced by the labor process. And in my view, there was no doubt that the financial market could not go on existing and could not go on prospering if they were not connected to the real, the so-called real economy. You have to think of, I know it's the case too in Brazil, that the share of public budget mean taxpayer people. That means share of taxpayer revenue. That means share of value of people involved in a labor process, earning wages, is a share of their revenue, of their wages, being extracted for the payment of debt service. You know how high is the share of the debt service paid by the Brazilian government, exactly as the, as in France, the payment debt, payment service has become now the second post in the public budget, just after education. Second post. So very, very, very important. So there is no doubt that the casino game would not go on, would not last very long if it was only fed by the wealth of people and engaging their money and risking and betting their money on this casino. No, there was no doubt that the casino, in two brackets, is fed by the real money, the real value.
Pardon?
By the impoverishment of workers,
sure.
For example, it's feeding the impoverishment of the working class.
Sure,
it's
sure. It's the most basic fact acknowledged by any official international institution. It is the change in the distribution of revenue between capital and labor. I mentioned, but I just jumped too quickly on that. I mentioned in my slide, the last ILO, International Labor Office report, which is more heterodox than OECD, for instance, and we tried to break down the source of the change in the distribution between labor and capital, which is a basically accepted fact. And they found, I have in my slide the reference, now I have the file for those interested, they found that almost, roughly, 52% of the driving cause for the change in the distribution between labor and capital revenue between 94 and 2007 or so, 52 is accounted for by what they call financial globalization. And they minimize at 20% or so as an explaining factor the role of technology. I mean, people have become impoverished because they are laid off and so on and so forth. The main factor, the main driving force for the imbalance is caused by, not by globalization, by financial globalization. That means the point I made in my presentation, the role of capital and so on and so forth. Very interesting question raised by my colleague on what I wrote in the paper published in early 2014, challenging the notion of transnational capitalist class. You might know that it is a thesis argued by some researchers that with globalization there have also been a kind of transnationalization of the ruling class. And I challenge this view, and you are kind enough to refer to my paper, and I try to explain what I mean on your question. First, there is a kind of unification, institutional unification of the different fraction of capital, if you want. In my view, at least, conglomerate like Carrefour is a financial group. When you look, and it had been made in France, when we look at the source of the profits of the large supermarket stores, Carrefour, Auchan, Casino, three very large world French group, you can see that the bulk of the profits is not generated by the sales of your goods, of meat, of drink, generated by the financial profit drawn from the difference between the time when goods are paid by the customer, I mean today, and the day when those megastores will pay their suppliers. Milk cooperative, meat cooperative, Coca-Cola, Danone, and so on, will be paid by Auchan, Carrefour, and Casino only between 50, in French at least, between 50 and 70 days. And when you imagine the daily turnover of this kind of supermarket, you can understand why this kind of gain drawn between the different time between the payment by one and the payment to the other is very important. So there is no doubt that, of course, their business, the fraction of capital, if we reread Marx, would be the commercial capital and so on. So it would come at the end of the process, because before you have to advance money and then produce, and there are different fractions. There are different fractions, no doubt about that. But institutionally, so to speak, not functionally, of course, functionally, you have always to sell a good which has been produced, like it was 200 years ago, or like it was 50,000 years ago. So functionally, of course, the capital remain divided along different lines. Some are specialized in finance, others in retail, and so on and so forth. But I could say institutionally, and socially speaking, to some extent, in my view at least, this kind of different fraction of capital have been unified, not united, unified under the umbrella of what is called finance capital, in the broader sense, of course, not in the sense of banking capital. So it is the first point. And of course, this kind of analysis, I mean a kind of unification under the auspices of finance capital, can be associated with the remaining national dividing line. And you are right to point to this this point. It's not so much unfortunately in terms of let me take the problem the other way around. It's for what you call competition reason. I mean, even if they are unified as a finance capital, they remain divided along national lines, because financial capital is not living in the air. Again, for finance capital institution, I mean Auchan and so on, they have to be in connection with the production of value. And the production of value, as explained in this paper, still goes on territorially circumscribed and politically built. I mean, in the French top transnational, and the French are quite good in the ranking of the number of top transnational corporations. Still today, the average goods and so on is held by Pinot. Pinot makes only 9% of its turnover in France. But EDF, the power giant, maybe you know EDF, Electricité de France, is making today 90% of its turnover. So, of course, you have difference in the degree of internationalization, disconnection of capital with their own basis. But even, of course, so I will not discuss of EDF, it's evident that EDF is still remain connected with the French regulatory power institution which help EDF to compete at the European level because there is a deregulation of the power market in Europe, so EDF remain strongly buttressed on its domestic base, but benefited from the French government support to acquire Italian, for instance, and British power companies. No, I do not discuss of EDF, it's evident. But even for Pinault, for now renamed Kering, I mean, we sell perfumes and luxury goods and wine in China and so on, it goes on needing the French market. He needs the French market because one of the most brands are produced and designed in France. The shareholder, family group, who owns 40% of the Kering group, still on living in France. He has relation, the family has relation with the French government, benefited from some kind of export subsidized and so on and so forth. So of course, the degree of dependency of French group on their own market could be different, but basically as a whole, they remain dependent on the French economy and social relations. So I think that globalization, even financial globalization, did not blur the national boundary. And you have explained an example I gave in a previous presentation with the role of banks, not financial corporations, but banks. You could think that banks are the most advanced in the globalization of their activities and the more distant of their national base. It's exactly the other way around. What evident very, very, very strongly the European crisis, European bank crisis, is that the banks return, with the support of their government, of course, return to their own base to receive subsidies, to be protected from a regulatory point of view, and so on and so forth. So you can see that banks, which were said to say internationalized, are very, very dependent, and I think that it's the same case for the US bank. And finally, the last question I will address. Yes, I think that the extravagant stock value of Google, of course, in this case, due to real innovation. There is no doubt we are exploiting, each of us exploiting the opportunity given by Google, but again, exactly like for Apple, exactly I think like for Apple, the most of the value, the stock value of Google is due to what we call the intangible asset. And when I mentioned just a moment ago the feedback effect between the stock market value and the strategy of the firm, I forgot to mention in the case of Microsoft, but now it's well known with Google that because they are so much stock valued and they are so wealthy thanks to the stock market, they are able to be in a very asymmetrical position as far as
the power of this concept. I mean, you have probably heard of a very, very looming theoretical conflict between Google and other startup and small and medium company will discover some, will invent, sorry, some kind of new innovation. I don't know exactly what. And just Google try to kill them through a very, very uncompetitive strategy, making appear their Google own software, on, for example, on mapping. There was a conflict between Google and a mapping software company. So you can see that, again, the stock market reinforced the company and reinforced the so-called power market power of the company to the point to kill innovation to some extent. So I think that even if Google and is really creative, there is no doubt about that, the value of Google is over exaggerated and still does not rely on the Google innovative activities now, right now, but more and more on the market power of Google. We have the same case with Microsoft, that's been a lot evident how Microsoft killed the competition and was able to remain at the top of the competition, not only or mostly thanks to its innovative activities, but thanks to its power on the market. So there is no doubt about that. Too long.
Do you have a take on that? Would you subscribe this intuition that capitalism, because of financialization, has become less dynamic, because firms will tend to invest less. If you take some of your slides, you have shown to us that, okay, part of the firms are investing less. The top 1,000 are really investing less, or the corporations, the US corporations, have a higher ratio between cash and investment. But this does not necessarily mean that in the aggregate, investment is falling, because other firms, maybe not even in the United States, but elsewhere, may be investing for that, because they are, because firms have downsized, firms have sold assets, firms have hired other firms to do the productive, dirty job for them. So it's more complicated to think in terms of the aggregate as a microeconomist. That's my question.
Claude, thank you very much for your presentation. It's really outstanding. I have a question here. If I understood what you have said, we can you have demonstrated to us that there is an increasing power of transnational corporations, and at the same time, a decreasing power of national states. The national state was very important in a historical perspective after the Second World War, for instance, as a countervailing power to avoid or prevent some of the most disruptive tendencies of capitalism. Then you have shown that there are some striking trends in the domain of workforce inside the transnational corporations. Fall, for instance, of 4-6% in the share of labor and the value added for transnational corporations. We can understand this phenomenon because we have a great transformation in the world of labor. We have ended an era of stable jobs, well-paid jobs, and jobs for all the life, and we are living an era of flexibility. But one could say that this is a phenomenon that affected in a more intense way the periphery of the system, but it's not true, because we know that this is a phenomenon very important inside the nucleus of the most developed countries in the world nowadays. And there are striking data for this guy here. Guy. The name is Guy. Guy standing. Guy standing. That one quarter of the population live in a situation that he is calling the precarious. And I'm trying to think about what could be the forces that could transform our world. And do you believe, I don't know, it's really a little distant from what you have said, but we have talked about a lot before the speech. And do you believe this precariat, this movement of people that are completely isolated from the possibilities of having a good life, could be really a dangerous class, and a class that could produce some transformation in our world?
Okay. To some extent, some part of our question are connected with each other. Because I agree with most of what you said for an observation. I think that what you ask from me is to make a kind of prognosis or prognosis of on the future of capitalism. What you call macroeconomy is indeed what is the future of capitalism. Macroeconomy is just beyond that. And it's, of course, I do not intend to respond but I think that you pinpoint a very, very important issue. Is capitalism is still in an ascendant phase, not from a contractive point of secular, multi-secular, or my assumption, it's not really a new hypothesis because of course very difficult to demonstrate, but my tendency is that no, it is not any longer on an ascendant phase. I am on the side of people who think that we have today a kind of convergence between three types of crisis. You have, of course, the so-called financial crisis. You have then the over-accumulation crisis. Rather thinking that it is a kind of over-accumulation than under-consumption, but it's not very important for our group. I'm on the side of those who think that there is a real over-accumulation crisis. And the third aspect of the crisis, of course, maybe for them, for some, the most important is a growing contradiction between capitalism and nature. I mean the finitude of its natural resources and so on. Of course, I think that progress can be made, synthetic products can be found, but as a trend, I think that there is a kind of unsustainability, even from an ecological, restricted ecological point of view, unsustainability of the capitalist world. You could oppose this kind of view, not what you said, but what some said, I mean, that you have a macroeconomic growth at the world level, even if it is the macroeconomic level. Even if it is the rate of growth is declining, you have anyway this way. And of course, it's very important and take into account. And the factor we factor in is China. I mean, of course, one of the most oppositions that can be made to this declining tendency of capitalism in this view is the role of China. In China, you have a real productive accumulation, you have real growth, and so on and so forth. So we are driven back to the discussion of what capitalism is. Does capitalism can go on growing? What, and if yes, does it mean a kind of catching up of some countries? China is a country. It's catching up of some countries by other countries like China, It is a kind of an even and combined development rather than catching up process. So the point that I want to make is it's very difficult to just respond in 3 minutes. I just propose a kind of analytical framework. I mean, one, we have a very structural crisis, like environmental, economic, and financial crisis. And two, of course, capitalism, see from better, is always recreating accumulation, and China is a very outstanding example. But you have to take into account the fact that we are not living in a relentless process of capital accumulation. We are not in the process where China could be assimilated at some part of the United States of America at the end of the 19th century, in which, of course, some industrial sector declined and other instead grew. You have the growth of the automotive industry, which outperformed more older which we are speaking of China, not of a territorial process taking part, taking form in the world in general. When I say China, I say, of course, on geo-economic, geo-rivalry with the US. So you have to take into account that if you are optimist, or optimist, even if you are political, if you think that capitalism is able to overcome even the Swiss crisis I mentioned before, look at China, look at the macroeconomic growth at the world, etc. You have to take into account international geopolitical rivalry, geoeconomical rivalry. The fact that China is accumulating so quickly and so strongly could, of course, be a point for those who argue that capitalism is always reproducing on an expanded scale its domination. But you could also look at China, its international contradiction, the fact you have a ruling class, how could we call it, communist capitalist class. It's really a novelty. And could we think that this type of ruling class, this novelty, will last forever? Or is it riddled with a lot of contradiction, international contradiction? Of course, of external contradiction, and we agree, with other national, still national capitalism, think of the US to begin with, which are not decided to leave China, begin a peer competitor, as it is said, in the national, US national strategy. Never in China will be allowed to become a peer competitor, a pair, the parent peer. So, those are factors which minimize, in my view, the fact that at the world level, capitalism is still growing. There is no doubt about that, but with the kind of contradiction I mentioned. And it's a reason why I'm rather skeptical and concerned, absent, of course, deep change the political and social landscape. I am rather concerned with what is called the new lumpen proletariat, the precariat. I did not read the book yet, but I will do. I think, of course, the point was very, very strongly made by good orthodox mainstream economist called Richard Freeman, who is critical of neoliberalism, but who is a very, very mainstream and well established economist, who explained just 3 or 4 years ago and still go on explaining that the world has changed for workers to the extent that now capitalism, because the word capitalism, use the word business, is able to make it and over 3 billion workforce in the world. So we can be a workforce with like Eastern European countries or like in China and in other developing countries, very skilled. There have been tendency, a rise in the level of education, of course. People now are not only unskilled, but really able to perform some high-skill activities which used to be performed by the core industrial workforce. So I am absent a deep change in the political and social context. I am deeply concerned, and I think that the evidence my concern is wrong. You will see in 2 months a landslide victory for the right-wing, extreme right-wing party, like was the case in France just 2 days ago, because of the despair by people, they have no future in Europe. They see that after 7 years of crisis and very, very, very constraining macroeconomic policy, very austerity-led policy, things are not changing at all. At all, there is no the beginning of change. The last European Commission report released in October 2013 said that it seems that we are going out of the recession, and they gave as an example the fact that the European stock market rose by 21% in 2013, evidencing the fact that the market were optimistic. And a few pages just after, I mentioned this graph, this table, in my first presentation 3 weeks ago, they forecast an increase in the rate of unemployment in 2014 and 2015. So you can not find better evidence that there is no, at least short term, no future for European people. So, finally, I agree with you. I did not say that the rate of productive investment was declining everywhere, and in particular for the reason you mentioned, and I hope to have been understood. I mentioned two. I mean that even the transnational corporations need to draw upon the creation of value, so they need some companies. Sometimes they affiliate themselves, of course, to produce the value and to invest productively. But your question was not, I think, on that, because it was rather the point I mentioned. Does it mean that because transnational corporations need the production of value, that at the low level, capitalism is expanding? My response is no. I think that transnational corporations needs the production of value, but they have nothing to do, and this fact has little to do with a macroeconomic or international expansion of capitalism. I mean, you have a real contradiction, well known, between the fact that what is good at the micro level, even for a large corporation, is not good or not needed for the whole economy in general. And finally, on the question of the countervailing power of nation state, I think you are right to, of course, pinpoint to the weakening of the national government, but I would say that it is more a change in the way the state institution act, which is important, more important than a real weakening of state. I'm thinking of core countries. I'm not thinking of emerging or developing countries. I'm thinking of developing countries. It's difficult for me to accept the idea that the French state is weakened. No, the harshness with which President Hollande acted to support, with no success at all, business, capital, evidence, it's French. It's quite in conjunction with the needs of the French business. And basically, we could say the same thing for the other European governments. So I am always not reluctant, but cautious when I hear the weakening of state. To begin with, there are more states now in the world than in the past decade. I mean, the creation of a state is a perpetual process, so of course it can be weighed, but there were more and more land and more states. So, and two, of course, I agree with what you say when you speak of weakening. It means the kind of bargaining you mentioned that has been raised just in the aftermath of World War II. I mean, there is no doubt that this kind of weakening will last for some years, I am afraid of. But it could be a weakening of the kind of social bargaining set up after World War II. It could be a weakening at the benefit of the reinforcing of what is in Europe begin to be called the authoritarian state. You have a burgeoning literature, not the beginning of the literature, explaining, and just to mention this point at the end of my presentation, my first presentation, that because the EU is not a state as such, it's not based on a kind of consensus, a state to dominate, to rule, doesn't mean only the monopoly of the legitimate coercion, as Weber used to say, but also a kind of consensus. I accept this kind of neo-Gramscian view, sociological view that the state can rule only by force. It needs consensus. And the fact that, on the one hand, the European institution, including the Intergovernmental Council, is given more power on the one hand, and on the other hand, that the same European institutions are totally, fully deprived of any kind of consensus, popular consensus, democratic, lead some researchers to conclude that we are going in the direction of an authoritarian European state. I mean, a state endowed with political power, but with a missing democratic approval. So, I agree with this kind of view. I'm not an inventor of this kind of thinking, but I think that it has been in part correct, and of course it could be the awakening of the social consensus-based state at the benefit of an authoritarian state. I'm afraid of that.
Thank you, Claude. Obrigado.